The volumetric efficiency in internal combustion engines depends on the level of cylinder filling. The higher the volumetric efficiency, the higher the engine's efficiency, the lower the fuel consumption, and the lower the exhaust gas emission. In naturally aspirated engines, the volumetric coefficient is less than 1. For better filling of cylinders, chargers are used. There are dynamic and independent chargers. In the previous lesson, dynamic chargers were described. They use natural physical phenomena to charge. When there is a need for better filling of the cylinders with the mixture, independent chargers are used, which are also the subject of this lesson. Turbocharger systems. Independent chargers use some form of external energy as a drive, which can be exhaust gas, electrical, or mechanical. The most famous is the turbocharger. The kinetic energy of the exhaust gas flow is used to drive this charger. A turbine is installed in the exhaust pipe. When the engine ejects the exhaust gas in the fourth stroke, it hits the turbine blades, causing it to rotate. The rotation of the turbine wheel is transmitted via the shaft to the compressor wheel impeller in the intake manifold. The compressor blades push the air towards the engine cylinders. In this way, a higher pressure of the intake air and a better filling of the cylinders with the mixture are achieved. Turbochargers work practically without losses because they use the energy wasted through the exhaust gas flow. A significant supercharging effect is achieved at medium and high engine speeds. Depending on the design of the turbocharger, the compressor rotor achieves rotation speeds of 50,000 to 400,000 revolutions per minute. Due to the increased temperature of the exhaust gas and the high-speed rotation, the turbine shaft is lubricated and cooled with engine oil. The exhaust gas temperature in gasoline engines can exceed 980 degrees Celsius, while in diesel engines it is slightly cooler and ranges from 770 to 820 degrees Celsius. This temperature can destroy the turbocharger if not controlled. Due to the high rotation speed, the turbine shaft is mounted on fully floating bearings lubricated with motor oil. The bearings have external seals to prevent oil leakage. Engine oil is delivered and drained to the turbocharger shaft through the pipe. The oil passes over the bearings and returns to the engine oil pan through the outlet pipe. Oil circulation cools the turbocharger. Often, due to poor lubrication and overheating, damage to the shaft, bearings, and seals occurs, which leads to oil leakage into the intake or exhaust pipe of the engine. Keeping the turbocharger cool and well lubricated is essential to the unit's durability. The turbocharger usually starts compressing the intake air when the engine speed is above 2,000 revolutions per minute. At these speeds, the force of the exhaust gas flow creates a sufficient rotation speed of the turbine, which is transferred to the rotation of the compressor blade to create overpressure in the intake manifold. In naturally aspirated engines without a charger, the charging pressure is around 0.7 bar, which is much lower than the atmospheric pressure of 1 bar. With a turbocharger, the charging pressure can reach a value of 1.7 bar. The higher the engine speed, the higher the charging pressure. If the pressure becomes too high, self-ignition of the mixture occurs, engine power is reduced, and the combustion pressure in the cylinder can increase so much that the engine self-destructs. Therefore, the maximum charging pressure must be controlled by stopping or slowing down the operation of the turbocharger. There are several ways to control the operation of the turbocharger. Mechanical pneumatic control. Electronic control. Variable geometry turbine control. A bypass line is installed in the exhaust pipe parallel to the turbine. Regulation of the passability of the bypass line is performed via a vacuum valve. When the bypass line is closed, the entire amount of exhaust gas passes over the turbine. When the valve is opened, part of the exhaust gas goes through the bypass line, which reduces the amount on the turbine blades and thus reduces the charging pressure in the intake manifold. When the bypass line is fully open, the operation of the turbocharger is reduced to a minimum. With mechanical pneumatic control, the vacuum valve is connected to the intake manifold behind the throttle via a vacuum hose. When there is a low charge pressure in the suction line, the valve is closed. When the charging pressure increases, pressure in the intake manifold increases, which acts on the diaphragm and opens the valve. When the filling pressure is too high, the valve is open. The valve redirects the exhaust gas through the bypass line and dampens the operation of the turbocharger. Newer engine models use electronic control of the vacuum valve operation. The electronic control unit monitors the charge pressure from the MAP sensor or makes an estimate based on other data. Through the electromagnetic valve, the ECU controls the vacuum supply to the valve. When a vacuum is applied, the valve opens fully, and the exhaust gas bypasses the turbine. At lower engine speeds, the ECU feeds outside air into the vacuum regulator, and the valve is closed. In more modern models, the ECU can regulate the amount of vacuum supplied to the vacuum valve. In this way, there is a fine regulation of the turbocharger's operation over a widening range of engine speeds. The advantages of electronic charging control compared to mechanical pneumatic control are: faster response, constant power output because it is independent of the change in pressure in the intake manifold, variable charging pressure that can be increased to the limit of the occurrence of mixture self-ignition, charge pressure control with variable turbine geometry is used in modern vehicles. Regulation is carried out using rotating inlet vanes, which control the flow of exhaust gas to the turbine. Around the entire outer circumference of the turbine are vanes that can rotate. The vacuum regulator turns the ring via the control lever. The adjusting ring over the guides equally rotates the wings and places them in the proper position. The vanes redirect the incoming exhaust gas to the turbine blades. Depending on the angle of incidence of the exhaust gas on the turbine blades, the force and speed of the turbine rotation are regulated. At low engine speed, the wings are set high. The narrowed passage increases the flow speed of the exhaust gas. At the same time, the exhaust gas flow acts on the outer surface of the turbine blades, which increases the leverage effect. All this affects the increase in turbine speed and charging pressure. At higher engine speeds, the vanes open, increasing the passage and redirecting the jet to the lower part of the turbine blade. The exhaust gas has a weaker flow, and due to the shortening of the lever, the turbine rotates more slowly. Thus, the turbocharger does not exceed the critical cylinder filling pressure that can destroy the engine. When air is compressed, its temperature increases to 180 degrees Celsius. Increased air temperature can cause the mixture to self-ignite. Also, the heated air expands, and the amount of oxygen decreases, which reduces the effect of overfilling the cylinders. An intercooler is used to cool the air. It is a cooler that takes heat from the compressed air before it reaches the engine cylinder. It is located between the turbocharger and the engine. With a lower temperature, the charging pressure can be increased, the self-ignition of the mixture is prevented, the engine output power is higher, fuel consumption is reduced, and the emission of nitrogen oxides is lower. Engines with turbochargers have one drawback, which is reflected in a slower response when the throttle is quickly opened. For example, the driver's desire for higher speed by suddenly pressing the gas pedal. The exhaust gas needs a certain amount of time to generate enough energy to spin the turbine to respond to the change in speed. This delay is called the turbo lag. The lack of a turbocharger due to the appearance of a turbo lag can be covered by the use of high-speed compressors with electric or mechanical drive. They turn on when a quick supercharging response is required and turn off when the turbocharger kicks in. The electric charger has a startup time of 350 milliseconds and a rotation speed of 60,000 revolutions per minute. When used at a lower engine speed from 800 to 2,000 revolutions per minute, it improves the torque by up to 45%. Since the electric charger consumes a large amount of electricity for its work, it is switched on briefly to cover the turbo lag. The mechanical charger, or Rust's compressor, is driven directly from the engine. It is switched on via a magnetic clutch. It is activated during acceleration and at full engine load. It can also be used independently without a turbocharger. However, they are big consumers because they consume part of the generated mechanical energy, up to 20 kilowatts. They are used in high displacement engines and higher class vehicles where fuel consumption is not a primary feature. In modern vehicles, independent chargers are used more and more because even with the use of a smaller volume engine, high torque and high output power are obtained with lower fuel consumption and lower emissions of exhaust gases. In combination with dynamic superchargers, the maximum is extracted from the internal combustion engine.